That was a wonderful time of worship, wasn't it? Really nice, and thank you very much for that, guys. Thank you for the kind and warm invitation to come here this morning and to be able to share with you. And this morning we've got some slides in the background that we'll try and go through, and hopefully we're able to share some of the work that we do with the charity. So the first, we've got three things we want to try and do today. First of all, I want to share God's word with you. The mask. The only opportunity I get to take the mask off, and I don't even take it. Do you want me to start again? I can take the glasses down now. I can see. Three things I want to do today. So if we move to the next slide for me, please. Thank you. First of all, I want to share God's word with you this morning. That's what we're here for, is to hear from God. Secondly, I'd like to share about the work of Connect 2 Teen Challenge with you also this morning, the charity that we're involved in. And thirdly, we are here to share testimony of a life changed, a life transformed. I trust in the very presence here that you are here this morning, that you'll be blessed, that God will use something that we have to say to encourage you, to inspire you. Firstly, this morning, I want to share from a well-known passage from the Bible. We'll turn to the next slide. It's referred to as the parable of the Good Samaritan. The parable of the Good Samaritan is one of the most famous parables Jesus ever told. The term Good Samaritan has become synonymous with someone who shows mercy and kindness. It's a positive name. Many organizations today actually use that name and call themselves after the name Samaritan. There's ministries called after it. There's homes called after it. There's hospitals named after it. There's even laws that have been passed based on the name the Good Samaritan. But the Good Samaritan's meaning would have been much different back in the day when Jesus was talking to the audience that he was speaking to. For those who first heard the Good Samaritan story, it would not have held such a positive outlook. To the Jews, a Samaritan was anything but good. So this morning, I want to look at this passage afresh so that we can learn from it. And I believe no matter where we are on our journey of life this morning, that we can glean something from this story. It doesn't matter where we are on our spiritual journey. If we afresh come this morning expecting God, as we were saying earlier today, to speak into our lives, then we can go away being uplifted and maybe even challenged in change in our lives. Before I start, I'm going to pray. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that we've got the opportunity to open up your word today and to be able to speak from your word, to read your word, to hear from your word. Lord, we do want to open our eyes and to see Jesus through the whole of our service today. May it be that afresh our eyes would be opened up, that we'd take the focus off of ourselves and look at Jesus. Help us to understand what he's trying to say to us this morning. May it be each one of us would be challenged, encouraged, uplifted, and maybe even changed. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you have your Bibles with you today, if you'd like to turn to Luke chapter 10, and we'll be starting to read from verse 25. The scriptures are on the screen behind us also. Verse 25, reading from the NIV version. On one occasion, an expert of the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law, he replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied, do this, and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Next slide. In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going by down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. This story starts off in verse 25 with the lawyer, the religious leader, testing Jesus by asking him a question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? We know his motives. Luke makes it clear that the lawyer isn't interested in the question. He just wants to test Jesus. Next slide. We, as a charity, Teen Challenge, are following a 63-year history. Connect 2 is a sister charity to Teen Challenge. We are part of that family. And most of you will know here that Teen Challenge came out of the Cross and the Switchblade, the story there told of David Wilkerson and how he worked in the streets of New York. And so we're a local charity that has come out of that wonderful, wonderful history. Teen Challenge is well known around the world. Next slide. It's in 125 countries now. Amazing to think that a charity over 63 years has grown so much. They work with men and women who, like the man in the story, if they never received intervention in their lives, they may never have survived. Drugs and drink can destroy lives. Drugs and drink does destroy lives. Not only the individual themselves, but their family. At the very heart of what Teen Challenge started to do, working in those streets in the worst areas of New York, was helping folks to get their lives back on track. And of course, the very heart of what Teen Challenge was 63 years ago wasn't about the rehabs, wasn't about the various outreach works as such. It was evangelism. It was about sharing the love of God with those we came into contact with. And guess what? 63 years later, that is still the same aim of the charity today. We want to encourage folks to be able to meet with Jesus. In the story we read today, the lawyer knows his stuff. He's likely memorized all of the law, the scriptures. Because he's so familiar with the law, he knows that this is not an easy question to answer. Again, he's not asking because he's not asking because he's interested in the answer. He's asking because he wants to trip Jesus up. And the question he asked would trip up even the best of teachers of the day. Next slide. When we meet people on the streets as a charity, it's invariably not their spiritual lives they're concerned about. We are dealing with folks who are homeless. We're dealing with folks who are isolated, abandoned. In many ways, they're out of family and they're dislocated from society. We talk about the guys and the girls that we come across in addiction, that the devil has got them under the weapon of mass destruction. We've heard that phrase under war, but we see this as the world war, the weapon of mass destruction, drugs and drink. The God of this age has blinded the minds of the unbelievers. Most have tried to get their help by going here and there. They might get taken away and given help for 6 weeks and are put back on the streets. Teen Challenge will try and take them away and give them a 12, 15-month program in which they will get the time for to get the healing that they require, because generally they've had years and years worth of their drink and their drugs. Next slide. We refer to what happens in people's lives as if it's like a car crash. that sense of where something happens in people's lives, where their lives goes off the rails. It may be that someone is growing up having multiple car crashes in the family life and their life goes out of kilter, and the fact is they're not able to thrive in the family home because possibly parents are drinking or on drugs. One story to share this morning is of a lady we came into contact with. This lady was in a bad way. She came to one of our groups. She was brought by a Christian lady who had been praying for this lady, for an actual neighbor of hers, for many a year. And when we started up, she eventually brought her to the group. This lady could hardly walk some nights. She was falling about as she would be coming. That lady, as she grew up, she had 10 years working in a lawyer's office, 10 years or 15 years working in a school. Everything was going well until a car crash. Something came into her life that broke her life and broke it down into that sense of she turned to drink. But thank God that she came. She found hope. She found people willing to go the extra mile. And we're praising God this morning that she is in rehab and getting the help physically, mentally, more importantly, spiritually. Although this lawyer is a clever man, Jesus is also very clever. And how he responds to the lawyer is absolutely wonderful. Rather than answering the trick question, Jesus asks another question in verse 26. He knows that this lawyer would rather talk than listen. So Jesus throws the question back. What do you think? What do you think? And it's here the thing. He answered correctly. He gets it right because he refers, next slide, to verse 27. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Wow. You've answered correctly, Jesus said. Do this and you will live, Jesus tells him. But then he adds on, it's not okay just to know it. You've actually got to live it. The lawyer is sharp and he sees that Jesus just called him out on not living up to what he believes. Now he's faced with how to respond. He can either change his ways or he could try and justify his actions. And that's what he tried to do, was justify his actions. He said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Next slide. Isn't that a good question this morning? Who is our neighbor? Who is our neighbor? As a charity, we know who we want to reach out to, the most vulnerable people within Scotland, folks who are homeless, often on the streets, often begging. But in this story, I believe it speaks to each one of us this morning, no matter where we are at, no matter how young, no matter how old we are. We need to be challenged this morning to think about who our neighbour is. Who is the scripture speaking to me about this morning? There's a sense of where there's people in all of our lives that we'd rather not befriend. There's people in our lives that we don't necessarily want to go on with, but yet, this morning, I would suggest that that's where God wants to do his business with you, in order that you go and speak into their lives. You do something in their lives that they don't expect. Who is my neighbor? The lawyer, realizing he can't actually live out the law perfectly, he searches for the loophole. He's trying to justify himself. He's not interested in following Jesus. He just wants the rewards. He doesn't want to know who his neighbor is. Actually, he wants to know who his neighbor isn't. That way he can narrow the field so he can claim that he's fulfilling the law. Before we go about thinking this guy, bad about this guy, again, hold that mirror up to ourselves this morning. We do the same thing, don't we? We look for loopholes so we can do what we want to do and still get the rewards. We actually not any better many times. He was also following a common teaching of the day. There was a clear distinction that your neighbor was only going to include the Israelites or the Jews. What Jesus is about to do is expand the parameters of who your neighbor is, far beyond what the lawyer, what the audience who were listening, what the Jews would have been comfortable with. He does this by telling them the story of the Good Samaritan. Although I'm sharing about the work of Teen Challenge today, I would like us all to be thinking, as I've said already, who is that neighbor that maybe is already in our minds that we are thinking that we are being prompted this morning by the Holy Spirit to be thinking about? Someone you wouldn't ordinarily speak to, somebody who's given you a bit of grief at work, somebody who's given you a bit of problem in the street. Maybe that's the neighbor God is prompting you this morning to be thinking and praying about. The parable of the Good Samaritan is a response to both questions the lawyer asked. Jesus doesn't just address the justifying question, who is my neighbor, but also the first question, what I must do to be saved. Based on these two questions, Jesus launched into the actual parable. The story of the Good Samaritan, starting from verse 30, tells us that story. The story itself is fictional, but the details are pulled from real life. Starts off with a man traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, an approximately 20-mile road. This road was known to be dangerous. Thieves would often hide in the caves, on the cliffs, and ambush those who were unsuspecting on that road. It's not a route that you should have been taking alone. And from the beginning, those listening would have recognized how foolish it was for this man to take the route by himself. Of course, what happens? The inevitable happens. The traveler's beaten up and robbed, to no surprise to those listening to Jesus, his audience. The lawyer must be thinking, what a stupid man he was. He got what he was coming to him, but this isn't the story of consequences of foolish decisions. Jesus is about to throw a curveball in here. The traveler is badly beaten and barely hanging on to life when a priest comes across his path. But his initial hopes were soon dissipated. Not only does the priest not help, but Jesus also makes it clear that he went out his way to pass by on the other side. Next slide. It's easy for us to criticize someone going to the other side. I became a Christian at the age of 12, unchurched. I wanted to share the love that was given to me with others. But yet, when it came to this group of people that I'm now been privileged to be part of in the charity, those who were drunk, those who were out their face, I couldn't speak to them. I would cross the other side of the road. For 20 odd years as a Christian, as I grew up, I had no dealings with someone with their addictions. I just didn't know I had anything to share or anything to say to them because I felt I had nothing to give. Next, a Levite comes by. Surely he will step in and help. No, he too passes on the other side. To really understand what's going on here in Jesus' story, they need to understand the customs of the day. Both of these guys were clergymen. A priest's job was to officiate temple sacrifices, and the Levite was to help maintain the temple and its services. Both of these jobs require them to remain ceremonially clean while on duty. There was a list of things they could and could not do. There was things that they couldn't touch dead bodies, they couldn't touch body fluid. In essence, the religious leaders were placing their adherence to the rules over the needs of this man. They missed the point. These religious leaders were more concerned with their outward appearance of cleanliness rather than the actual condition of their heart. Next slide. When we work on the streets, you wouldn't need to be concerned about appearances. Helping individuals who are seen as manipulative, often unkept, loud. But you know, that's where the mandate to go comes into place. I told you for 20 odd years I couldn't have spoken to individuals because I just didn't know what to say. I didn't know I had anything to share. Until one day God called me through an addict who came on my path as I was going to church. And I believe that day, because I said yes to that addict, my life was changed. What does that represent for us this morning? Is God calling you to do something? What is it he's calling you to do? We've got to take the first step, haven't we, before God will reveal the plan, before he'll reveal the next step for you. The lawyer's heart has to be sinking because he can see himself in the story. He would have likely done the same thing, but Jesus isn't done. But it's about to get worse for him. In verse 33, he says, "But a Samaritan." But a Samaritan. Those words today are lost on us. When we see the word Samaritan, we think of something good. The term good Samaritan would not have resonated with the audience. It wouldn't have resonated with this lawyer. The Samaritans were hated by the Jews. They were seen as half-breeds. There was an intense rivalry between them. In the lawyer's eyes, the Samaritans can do nothing right. But in this story, Jesus tells, it's the religious people that could do nothing right. Jesus doesn't stop with the Samaritan just checking on the guy. He goes above and beyond. Next slide. The good Samaritan not only has compassion, but his compassion moved him to action. Next slide. We, as a charity, started in November 2019. We had a vision to set up by the end of 2020 four locations for us as a charity. The reality was that we got started with two locations, and then we all were experiencing that wonderful lockdown. Wasn't it an amazing time where we could do nothing, we could go nowhere, and we thought we're not going to be able to realize our vision. But God had other plans, and by the end of 2020, we were out on the streets in four locations. We go out four nights a week, and a Tuesday night, we go to Grangemouth. Wednesday, we go to Stirling. Thursday, we go to Falkirk. And Friday, we go to Alloa. We have met with many men and women, and some of the stories are so harrowing. It's amazing how people can still function, given some of their background stories that you hear of the car crashes that they've had in and through their lives. That's the work that I believe that I've been called to do. That was 20 or so years ago, I believe I was called to do that work. What has God called you to do? I believe he's got a work for every one of us. He cleans and binds up the wounds, brings him to an inn, cared for him and paid for his stay at great cost to himself. He ensured this man was cared for. This morning, I'm privileged to invite Tommy Rogers, who's going to come and share his story of how folks met him on his life journey, how his life was changed, how at the center of that, God can change anyone's life through Christian people caring for him. Tommy, come up and join us, please. Give him a round of applause to encourage him. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I just want to say thank you for inviting me here to share my story. Just like David said there, you know, that's exactly what it, that's it, my story really is. Christian people coming into my life and, you know, just showing me love, showing me care. I remember the first time I went to a wee church in Larns and it was just riddled with anxiety, you know, smashed to bits. And when I was going into the church doors, I thought, I just don't really want to be here. And as soon as I walked into the doors, these people, they just had a lovely smile and they could just see something in them. I thought, what is that? But obviously it was the Holy Spirit in them. And, you know, that's what drives me to change, really. But so my name, as I said there, my name's Tommy. I'm 37 years old. I'm from a small town in Dorai, Ayrshire. I don't know if any of you know it. It's like a wee seedy town, is the best way to explain it. Rangers daft, they're all Rangers daft. They used to paint the curbs and the pavements red, white and blue. In fact, one of my friends that I grew up with get the jail for painting the post box red, white and blue. And the police, the courts jailed him for an old law, which is defacing the Queen's property. So it was like mental. My both parents were alcoholics. So my family home was very chaotic. Growing up, I seen stuff that I was far too young to comprehend or even understand, but it was, I was seeing. And so my outlook on life was very warped and just warped and strange. I always felt growing up that no one ever listened to me. I never trusted anybody because of certain incidents that happened in my life. But as a young child, I grew up, and every weekend, every night, my mum and dad were just bevying, getting mad with a drink, fighting. My dad would batter my mother. It was just a normal thing. I grew up and thought that was normal. I just thought, wow, it's, you know, it's what you see. It's my world. So, and there was six of us all in. My mum had six boys. And my older brother, Graham, he was a drug dealer. And at the time, you know, growing up, you know, it's just a natural thing for a young boy to look for some sort of role model in his life. And looking at my dad, I knew that he wasn't, you just know that that's no right. The way he acted, the way he hit my mum, the way he was drunk all the time, I just knew that it wasn't attractive to me, even as a young boy. So I looked to my older brother, Graham, I wanted to be like him. He was like my god, if you like, growing up. But he was a drug dealer, so you can imagine how that went. You know, that was who I was looking at for. I wanted to be like him and stuff like that. But growing up in the family home, it was absolutely mental. You know, the police would be kicking the door in at least once every couple of months, raiding the house for drugs, because my big brother. And it got to the stage where the police women would come in, and there was me and my younger wee brother, Joe. The police would come in and say, right, Helen, to my mum, get the boys ready for school quickly and get them out to school before we get the dogs and stuff like that in to sniff about for drugs. So my big brother got wise to that, and he used to stuff my school bag and my wee brother's school bag full of drugs. So I'm just a wee fella, as you can imagine, with my wee Sonic the Hedgehog school bag on, stowing it to school, knowing that my school bag's full of drugs. And there was one time, this is where, because I developed a, you know, something breeded in me in my heart. It was like, you know, not to trust adults or people in authority because of this. So I'm going to school with a school bag full of drugs, and I'm sitting there, and the police come in to do a drugs talk this day. You know, and they come into my classroom, and they've got the suitcase, opened this suitcase, and it's got every drug you can think of. And I had about half of the drugs in my school bag. I'm only 6 year old sitting there like that, just, you know, watching guys put their hands up, and the police are going, does anybody know what this drug is? And I knew, well, fine, what the drug was, but I would never dare put my hand up. And I remember thinking, well, these boys are sitting, aye, that's hash and that's this. And I just remember panicking. So it was horrible. So growing, you know, going through school, I was an absolute mess. You know, a 6 year old boy with anxiety, it's never heard of, you know, and that's what I had. And, you know, I had the psoriasis developing in my elbows and my knees because I was always constantly having to second guess what was coming out of my mouth when I was speaking to teachers or social services or whatever, or any kind of adult. I had to think, right, hold on, what am I going to see here? Because the last thing I wanted to do was get my big brother into trouble. And police to me were bad guys that kicked my family door in, come rushing in. I was scared of police. And obviously that turned when I got to a teenager. I began to hate them. So by the end of primary school, I started flirting with smoking cannabis. I was stealing it from my big brother, going in his room and stuff like that. At the time, it was to steal tapes, music tapes, and to listen to music. Just a young boy doing what I do. And so I started smoking cannabis, and I was trying to escape because I witnessed something at a very young age that messed me right up. Come in the house for school one time, and I'm shouting. I took my school bag, I flung it in the living room. I'm shouting, "Mom, Dad!" Couldn't hear anything. Goes up the stairs, and I caught my dad in bed with another woman. And that messed me right up, because I'm just thinking, "Well, what was this?" And I never ever confronted my dad till later on in life, till the later years. But that messed me right up. So that just sent me on a path. I thought, right, you know what? I'm sick of this. I'm sick of trying to be good. I'm sick of trying to hide stuff. I just thought, you know, I just basically made a decision there and then. I'm just going to be the way I'm going to be. So I started being quite ruthless then. I was involved in crime quite a lot. My big brother, you know, he was selling drugs. I was collecting money for him. I was doing all sorts of stuff that I shouldn't have been doing. Quite nasty. I was a nasty piece of work for years. And as the years went on, I started going through the drug alphabet just because I started realising, you know, when I was getting mad with it, when I was getting full of drugs, I wasn't feeling this scared way all the time. My heart was, the reality was my heart was smashed to bits. It was broken. I was just a young boy getting about, you know, with a broken heart. But I couldn't show him this because I was Tommy Rogers. I was trying to be the big man. And so I was acting out. I was trying to act. I was just a young, broken guy trying to act the big man. And really, I was just smashed to bits, broken and hurt, crying myself to sleep most nights. But a situation happened with my big brother. Because he was a drug dealer, there was quite a lot of carry on going on with rival families, and something kicked off where my big brother Graham, he ended up going to prison. He was in remand for 3 attempted murder charges because of this kind of rivalry with the other family. And so when he was in prison, he developed a heroin habit. And he got out of prison, and when he came out, he got my wee brother into heroin. And I knew things were a bit different between the two of them because Graham had always told us, stay away from heroin. And all of a sudden, he comes out of prison, and him and my younger brother were always disappearing. They only tell me where they're going, but they get involved in heroin. And then I get the phone call one day. My big brother Graham had died. I was confused. I didn't realise what was going on. And the police, because he was estranged from his girlfriend at the time, the police took me into the house where he was, and I really wish, it's one of the things that I still to this day, I wish I never had to witness this. I had to go and view my brother's body in the bed he was lying in. And let me tell you something right now, it's a nasty, nasty thing, seeing somebody that's overdosing heroin and lay there for 3-4 days before he's been discovered. It was horrible. I can see it right now, clear as day. So that was the thing that split my family up. All the chaos that we'd been through, my mum and dad drinking, the fights, Christmas trees getting kicked out and all that, just the fighting constantly. That was the one thing that split my family up. My mum and dad split up when Graham died. I don't know if they blamed each other. I really don't know what happened, but they've split up. They both went their different ways. And so I moved away from Dorai because I was just getting sick, fed up of stuff. But my wee brother ended up, you know, he was bad with heroin. He was injecting heroin. It got to the point where Joe was in prison constantly and we just lost touch. So then my mother died and it was a drink that killed my mother. I think it was some sort of kind of like alcohol-induced stroke or something. I don't remember. She was poorly in health with diabetes and stuff like that anyway, all through alcohol. It was all through alcohol anyway, my mother. She didn't keep well. And so when my mother died, I remember coming back to Dorai because I moved to Kowinnan, and although I wasn't on heroin or anything like that, I was still swallowing all sorts of drugs, ecstasy, cocaine, just numbing myself basically, just trying to get on with life really, just trying to block out everything that was going on. So when I come back, I was the only kind of one of the brothers that was kind of compos mentis at the time, so I had to deal with the funeral and stuff. And I remember going to the doctors, and I says to the doctor, I says, listen, my mum's died. I'm struggling, blah, blah, blah. And the doctor gave me a prescription for Valium, diazepam, and Zoblicone. And I remember the first time I took the Valium, I thought to myself, oh, hold on a minute, I don't feel anything, to be honest with you. So in that form, it made me feel better, because I wasn't feeling anything. So from that day on, there was not a day by that I wasn't on Valium or diazepam, Valium. I was constantly taking these things. And and drinking alcohol. So when my mother's funeral, when my mother's funeral finished, I remember I made the decision that I would start to try and get some sort of clarity with my dad. Because although my mum and dad were alcoholics, and my dad, you know, he was just as much an alcoholic as my mother, there was moments of clarity where my dad would take me fishing and that as a boy. So I knew if I reached out to my dad, then maybe I'd be able to sort something out. And I'm glad I did, because near the end, I spoke to my dad, and you know, he apologised to me, and there was some sort of, I don't know how to explain it, but just, it was almost closed a chapter on that kind of thing. I got some sort of peace about it. You know, my dad apologised for the way we were treated, the way we were brought up, and, you know, I brought up the whole thing where he cheated on my mother, and he just, and I can understand it now. He just says, listen, I didn't know what I was doing. It was just, the reality is, he was just as much as washed up and warmed up as I was, really, to be honest with you. He had issues as well. But, you know, my dad died, and seeing my dad died, I just knocked kind of whatever wind I'd left in my sails at me. I just had enough. You know, I was like, I'm sick of this. You know, it's like life, what kind of life is this? Because of the way I'd been brought up, my view on everything was absolutely warped, and I just thought, this is a load of crap, this. So I just went down a very dark path. My dad's funeral took some time. It was like a good 8 to 12 weeks before the funeral, from the time he died. So during that time, I was just getting smashed all the time, full of Valium, and I almost made the decision. I was suicidal. I remember saying to myself, you know what, I've had enough of this. As soon as I get this funeral out the way, I'm off. I'm out of here. And the day of the funeral, I'll never forget it. I put my wee suit on. I was built like a, look at that there. It's terrible, that, isn't it? Some picture of that. It's like a poster campaign for neglected horses or something. But it's like, you know, that's the reality. That's what it was like. You know, it was just death there. And then there I look as if I'd won the lottery. But that's what's true. That's really what happened in my life. And so when I went to my dad's funeral, I made a decision. I'll go to the funeral. I'll get this over and done with, and then I'm going to kill myself because I'd enough. And I went to the funeral. And there's my wee brother, Joe, at the funeral, who I hadn't seen for probably 2 years, 3 years. Now, Joe was banging right in about the depth of heroin. He was injecting heroin. He was gone. Like, last time I seen him, he had a needle hanging out his arm. So I met my dad's funeral, and there's Joe with a suit on, looking fresh and healthy, and I'm like, what's going on here? So I thought to myself, I'm going to speak to Joe. I was like, all right, Joe, how are you going on? Are you just out of jail? Because normally that's what happens. The guys that are on heroin, they go to jail and they come out after doing a couple of years and they look all right. He's like, no. He said, I've not been in jail for a few years now. I'm like, well, what's going on with you like? I was like, Mom, we'll go and get a fag and we'll get a wee chat. And he's like, oh, no, I don't smoke anymore. He's like, but Mom, well, I'll come outside. And I'm like, what do you mean you don't smoke anymore? I was like, all right. I says, well, Mom, for a pint then. I says, well, I've got a wee chat, see what's going on with me. He's like, no, he says, I don't drink anymore, Ireland. I'm like, pfft. I says, what? What do you mean you don't smoke, you don't drink? Last time I seen you, you had a flipping needle hanging out your arm. He says, no, he says, I became a Christian and I went to rehab. And at that time, I was like, all right, aye, all right, like, that is it. And I just thought, all right, I'll just leave him be. I just thought he was putting on a show, to be honest, because that's where my heart was at. My heart was all twisted. It was broken. It was all over the show. And I went home that night, and I didn't kill myself, because I believe God put my wee brother at that funeral at that time to speak to me. And I just couldn't get my wee brother out of my mind. I just thought, wow, what's going on with this? Because in my eyes, Joe was far worse than me, but yet he was at my dad's funeral, just this glow that I was trying to explain to you. Like, I seen these people at church. And so I phoned him that night, and I'm like, what's Joe? I says, and I just broke down to him. I'm like, Joe, I need help. What's going on? How did you manage to sort yourself out? And he's like, I just went to rehab. And he put me in touch with this wee fella called Morris Craig, who's like, he works with Teen Challenge Bus and Lars, and he's just a cracking guy. Like, this guy's, you know, it's just like that David explained, it's just Morris is just, isn't he, the kind of type of guy that you think would be out there talking to drug dealers or that? This guy can sit in the gangsters down there by his house while they're sitting counting up money. But that's the level of respect he's got with people. He's just a lovely wee guy. He's just like, you know, and you just don't expect this guy to be out talking to people in the streets and that, but he does, and he's really good at it. And so he was putting my path, and he invited me to church one day, and I just thought, because Morris was a friend of the family for years ago as well, but when he invited me to church, I just remember thinking, no, I couldn't because I was smashed to bits. I felt as if I was walking like this all the time, riddled with anxiety. I couldn't even talk to somebody. Do you know that way, without any drugs in me? The thought of even getting on a bus was enough to give me a heart attack. That's how bad I was. It was horrible. I was just like, Morris, I don't know if I can do this. But he assured me, he took my hand, he's like, come on into church. And it was the best decision I ever made, because although, just encourage Jewish people in church, you know, although all this stuff had happened, and I spoke to my wee brother, and I flirted with the idea of going to rehab, the one thing that cemented it in for me to change my life, the catalyst for me going to rehab, was a wee cup of tea and a wee conversation and a smile with a wee old woman in that church. That was it, when it was like, boom, it hit me like a ton of bricks, and it was like, you know what, I'm gone. So don't be disheartened and don't think that God doesn't use you, because he will. And that's, I always say that. I keep in contact with this wee lady. I write to her constantly, and she's smashing light. And so I went to rehab, and I done the program, 11-month program. I'll never forget it, but I went for the interview in Winchester House. John McMahon, the manager, he called me into his office, and the way up, I was in the car with Morris, and I managed to get hold of some Valium, so I took a handful of Valium because I was just nervous. And I goes in, by the time I was up to Winchester House, I was bubbling. I'd no clays at that way, because Morris just told me it was just an interview. So I thought, oh, it's just an interview, great. Because at that time, I was just told me that it was getting help. No, told me it was actually going to rehab. So I was kind of wearing that like a badge. And so I goes up there, and I'm in John's office, and he's asking me all these questions. I'm treating it like a job interview, because I was kind of out of my face. And I was like, I think I'll be good for this place, you know, that, and saying all this kind of stuff. John reminds me about it all the time, slags me about it. But I'll never forget it when he says, right, Tommy, that's it, we've got a bed for you. And I'm like, oh, brilliant. So I was like, when do you want me back? Thinking I can go get back down the road for one last soiree or whatever. And he says, no, the bed's ready for you now. And I was like, I remember panicking. I was like, oh, no, what do you mean the bed's ready for me now? And I was like, looked at Morris, and I was like, hey. And I was like, oh, I've no clays of that with me. I said, I've not got any stuff of that with me. I'll need to come back. I'll come back in a couple of days. And John was kind of going for it. He was going to say, right, come back on Wednesday or whatever. Then Morris was like, no, it's all right. I'll get your clay sent up to you. I remember thinking, oh, what? And I'll never forget it. I sat in my room. Room one, it was in Winchester House. And I looked out at the grass, and there was this wee pheasant jumped along the grass. And I'm like, wow, what am I doing here? Like, you know, and I lay in my bed all day, you know, worried, because there was all these folk here that I didn't know. You can imagine it's a kind of scary place at first. And I remember one of the phase fours came into the room. He's like, right, Tommy, it's nighttime chapel. 10 o'clock, there's a chapel every night, 10 o'clock. There's one in the morning, there's one at 10 o'clock, but it's Thanksgiving, but you basically just, you bit of prayer for 15 minutes, and then you get to your bed. So I says, all right. So I gets up and sits in this chapel, and there's lovely wee spotlights in it. And then all of a sudden, it was but the first time I really experienced God in an intimate level. And it was all these boys just started. If you can imagine, just a very dark wee chapel with lovely wee spotlights at night time. These boys started praying, Lord, we just pray for Tommy. We just pray that you help him know that he's loved, and that we hope he has no anxieties at night, and hope he gets a good night's sleep. And I'm sitting there like, what's going on here? Like, I remember questioning myself, like, is this really happening? You know that way? Because I'd never experienced anything like that before in my life. And I thought, do you know what? This is going to be all right. So I went through the program. I'd gave my life to the Lord with Morris at a quarry in Kilburnie the week before I went into rehab. And it's not that I didn't fully understand what I was doing there. I was just desperate. I says, I'll do anything. Like, you know what? I'll do this. I'll never forget it. Sometimes I'll pull in the car whenever I'm down the road, you know, and I'll do a wee prayer on that. But, you know, through the program, it says in Psalm 23, I was just sitting looking up there on my phone there, actually. I was sitting there. And it's Psalm 23. And it's a scripture that spoke to me in my program life, and it was, you know, he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And that challenged me off through my program, because I'm thinking, who in their right mind would do that? You know, who prepares a table? Because in my mind, I pictured it, it's like a big long table, and all these guys that you've got to run-ins with. And then God spoke to me, boom, it hit me like a ton of bricks. It was like, no, the program's a table. And he brought me to this table in the presence of my enemies, it was all the stuff I'd been through, you know, like the addiction, broken heart, trust, relationships. These were all my enemies at the time. And I firmly believe that God created that program as a table for me to come and deal with all my enemies. And that's exactly what I did. As I went through my program, I dealt with hundreds of stuff. It was hard work, don't get me wrong. Really hard work, because I'm in a position now where I work there, and it's like, I always say this to a guy. Guys, when I see this, you need to change this. This needs to change, and I always say this. God forbid you come to a place to change and things get pointed out in you. It needs to change. Because a staff member said that to me in my program. It's hard work getting stuff pointed out in you. Oh, this needs to change. And it's like, especially when it's a day with character. Although we're in there with no character. We like to think of ourselves as this, that, and the next thing. But no, I changed. God changed me. And I got to the end of my program, and I was meant to be going down to Leadership Academy. There's a moving on place called the Leadership Academy. You go to learn more about God. It's almost like a kind of miniature Bible college kind of study thing. A lot of people go there to move further into God and do other ministry. And that was my plans. And then a position came up for me to... Well, John, the manager, asked me if I'd like to stay on and work out in the grounds, because I love the landscaping. During the work programme, in the centre, I was going to cut the grass. I loved that. So I stayed on for a year. I was the head of the grounds. I loved that. I mean, I was up there on my days off and that. I was really baby rabbits jumping about and stuff like that. Deers. It's amazing, the place, Butchester House. If you ever get a chance to come visit, honestly, I would. It'll blow your mind. And so I volunteered for about a year. Then I did an internship for a year, and I'd done more supports, work side of things. Then I got a full-time employment as a support worker. I loved it. I mean, I get to see God moving every day, and then I felt a shift happening in me, in my heart. I went to a church in Edinburgh Central. It's called, like, a Hillsong church. Great worship team and all that. It was amazing, and this lady gave me a word, and it was a word for God, and it was, you know, I don't know where it is, but there's some sort of change, and God just wants to know that he's 100% behind you in this. And at the time, I was flirting with the police. You know, I'd put an application for him in the police, and I thought, let's go to be that. And I got all riled up. And I was praying. Applied for the police, and it was happening so quick, getting past this phase, the next phase. And then all of a sudden, the senior role came up at Teen Challenge. And I thought, senior role? Senior support worker? I could never be that, you know? And I just thought, no, do you know what? I'll put in for it. There was 12 different applicants put in for it. I thought, I'll never get it, but if God's in it, I'll get it. And I remember putting in for it. And I'll never forget the interview for it. Like, it was an hour and a half long interview. Like, it was hard work. You put a tablet there and a tablet there. We fill holes in one. If you want to file in the other, join all the other senior staff there. It was hard work. Like, and riled me, gave me scenarios. Right, a scenario kicks off in the lounge. One guy's fighting with this one. Next thing, what do you do? And I just remember sweating, sweat dripping down my back. And then they got me in the last question. It was like, what was the last book you read? And of course, the last book I read was Dan Brown, The Lost Symbol. And I just thought, I had to just say it. I just came out and said it, you know, and they all laughed, and I just thought, I'm never getting this. I walked out there, I felt as if I had springs for legs. I was walking out like that. I had to go, in fact, I went straight in my bed after the interview. Head was burst. Like, wow, this is a nightmare. And then as the week went on, I just thought, ah, it is what it is. I've got the police thing going on anyway. Next thing you know, I get called into John's office. He says, well done. Congratulations, you get the job. I couldn't believe it. I thought, wow, I'll never forget it. And but that's what God does. You know, he took me for the pit, and he dragged me right up. You know, none of it's me. I'm no intelligent. I'm no smart. I'm not the quickest of folk, you know. But, you know, I just made one decision, and that was to follow him. And God's good, you know. I don't know, I mean, for the future, I don't know what my future holds. I'm enjoying my time right now at Teen Challenge, but I know any time I think about my future, and it's like, I think it's God speaking to me, it's like a constant progression. There needs to be constant progression, and I think that it's exciting for my life. It's like, as long as I'm following God, I know I'm constantly going to progress. But thanks for listening. I just hope that this speaks to somebody. Amen.
Thank you very much, Tommy. Tommy's story is not untypical with folks who we come into contact with where they've had car crashes, multiple car crashes growing up. That's not a life for children to grow up in. And to see Tommy clothed in his right mind is just an amazing... If we're able to influence one Tommy in our lives, it's worth it. Tommy, thank you very much. I'm going to... conclude our service today just with a few closing remarks. And there's that sense of where I'm asking you once more to be thinking about what's God been saying to you today. There's people came across Tommy's path, the most unlikeliest guy. At my background, most unlikeliest guy goes and works with Teen Challenge. But who's God speaking to you about? What is God speaking to you about this morning? Who can you be a good Samaritan to that doesn't deserve it? Tommy didn't deserve what Teen Challenge brought to the table, but none of us deserve what God gives each one of us. The reality is, how can we take what has been passed on to us to pass it on to someone else? 3 points, and then I'm going to pray. The Samaritan was hated by the religious leaders. So was Jesus. He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of the dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we would desire him, Isaiah 53 and verse 2. He rescued, point two, the person that needed him the most, as did Jesus on the cross. But God demonstrates his love for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He didn't wait till I got right in my life. Didn't wait until I became a Christian and came to church. Didn't wait till Tommy had been the rounded person he is today. He met him where he was at. The last point there. And he did all of this out of love for someone that could never repay him, as did Jesus. This story of the Good Samaritan was about a man who was willing to go the extra mile and a more. Are we willing to go the extra mile and more? He paid a debt he did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sin away, and now I sing that brand new song, Amazing Grace, for Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay. This morning, I trust that something's been said that may encourage you, inspire you, challenge you. There is literature on the table out there. It's free of charge. You may have read The Cross and the Switchblade, but maybe today somebody's been put in your heart that you want to now go and speak to. Take a book, give the book to them. If you haven't read the book, it's a book that can transform lives. Thank you for your time this morning. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you this morning that you are in the business of transforming lives. We thank you for the story that Jesus told that had such a deep implication to the man who came in order just to try and trip Jesus up. Lord, may it be that each one of us this morning haven't come here for our own gratification, but to come and to recognize Jesus for who he is, what he's done for us in and through our lives. Father God, we thank you this morning that you call those of us who are weak, but through you can become strong. May it be, O God, that each one of us would go away today being encouraged, having listened to Tommy's story of how you transformed a life that was taken from being in addiction, but chained from that addiction and now free in Christ and now a living testimony for your grace. Lord, may each one of us have a story to tell as we go away from this place. We thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my
chorus again.
Then sings my soul.